أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. I just done this introduction because I'm trying to save people from hell, and the ways that I'm doing this is by spreading the message. If I don't say this message, then on the day of judgment I'm going to be accounted for. Regarding all the brothers, that I got love for all the brothers, I'm all about spreading unity. But because this is Speaker's Corner, we're here not to fight or to spread blood or to shed blood. We're here to debate. And there's nothing wrong with debating, because the truth will always be victorious. So if I feel that I've got the truth, my brother here, I feel that he's better than, this is what I feel, I'm not trying to say he is, I feel he's better than everyone in the park. The reason is because he's born, no. Of course he's got to say no, because he has to be humble. You can't never say it. But the reason why I'm saying this is because he's born not Muslim. Like most people, if they were born Hindu, they'll be Hindu. If they're born Christian, they become Christian. If they're born Muslim, they'll follow their Muslim. So half of these people, or most of them, are just following their parents. But when I see someone that's a revert, I'll be honest with you, this is how I feel. I'm just telling you how I feel. When I see someone that's a revert, I respect him more than a person born Muslim. Because I don't know if this guy is just following his parents. If his parents were Hindu, he'll be Hindu. So this guy, this brother, has used his intellect, has used his brain, mashallah, which Allah gave him. And he has come to the... So I respect him more. I feel that he's more real than 99% of the park. That's what I feel.
Can I make a point on that?
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead. Yeah,
to me, a born... I mean, I know people say that about reverts. But I think a born Muslim has to go through a similar process. So they have to realise, if you're a born Muslim, just because your parents did, and if someone asks you, why are you Muslim, Modi? If you say, because my parents are Muslim, that's not really good enough, is it? So a born Muslim has to go through a similar process to a revert. Do you agree with that?
Yeah. No, sorry. The born Muslim, first of all, what's the signs of a believer? Allah loves you. I know Allah loves you because he brought you to Islam, right? He took you up. Now, you get more rewards than a normal Muslim. You get double the rewards. You do know this, innit? Yeah? Because you're a revert, yeah? Regarding me, my respect to you, I respect you according to your iman. And your iman, I believe, is more than the rest of the people. Like I said, I don't have the litmus test, like Ali Dawa says, the litmus test. He didn't know how to say it last time. It's not... to test someone's iman. But there's verses in the Quran that show who's a believer. First sign, Surah Al-Mu'minin, the Surah of the Believers. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, successful are the believers, those that are concentrating their prayers, humble in their prayers, you understand? خَاشِع, that they put all their energy in their prayers, you understand? That's the first sign. There's so many other signs, yeah? Regarding you, I believe when you've come into Islam, there's a lot of wolves that want to take you to their side. I call them wolves, hyenas. I don't know what they are. They want to take you. Everyone wants to drag you. Come to this side. Come to this side. How are you going to find the right side? How are you going to know that this is the real deal? This side. Because there's a hadith, I've read it, that from the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said the Christians will be 72 sects. The Jews will be 71 sects. The Muslims will be 73 sects. All will be in hell from the Muslims except for one. And then he hit Imam Ali's chest. He said the ones that followed Imam Ali. And he said 13 of those that followed Imam Ali, 12 of them will be in hell and only one will be in heaven. So it's not a joke. Even for me as a believer in Islam, the word Imam is mentioned 12 times in the Quran. It's mentioned 12 times. There is 12 Imams, whether you like it or not. The 12 Imams, Jesus had 12 disciples. Moses had 12 disciples. The Christians and the Jews, the ones that will be in heaven in this hadith, are the ones that followed the righteous successor after Jesus, the righteous successor after Moses, and the righteous successor after the Holy Prophet Muhammad was Imam Ali, without a shadow of the doubt. Ahmad ibn Hanbal, who is the leader of the Wahhabis, he wrote a book saying the fada'il al-sahaba, it means the attributes of the sahaba. Three-fourths of the book were all on Imam Ali. Three-fourths of the book. And Ahmad ibn Hanbal said, anyone who hates Imam Ali is a munafiq, and anyone who loves him is a believer. So the people that went to war with Imam Ali and thousands were killed, if we take hadiths from these people like Abu Huraira and so on and so forth, these hadiths are going to be biased against Imam Ali because they've got war with him, they got beef with him. And the Prophet said the sign of a hypocrite is that he hates Imam Ali. Ahmad ibn Hanbal says this, Tabari says this, Sahih Muslim, Bukhari, all the books have said this. So when we come to Islam, we come with logic. And anything that goes against the Quran, we don't take it. So when I come and I bring you proof, people are going to say, no, I'm following my parents. I don't want to listen to you. My parents are, for example, Wahhabi or Salafi or Sunni or Shi'i. I'm going to follow them, blind follow. That's why I don't want to talk to these people, because they've got culture, they're fixed, they're screwed, their brain is screwed. He doesn't want logic. He doesn't want evidence from the Quran. But when I see someone like you, I can talk to you because I know you use your logic and your intellect. So if I say to you, and I know you're fearless, you don't fear no one who's going to tell you, oh, become Wahhabi Salafi or I'll blow you up, for example. You're going to say, do what you want, mate. You know what I mean? Because you're not scared. You know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? You're not scared. You're scared. You're scared only of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why when I come and I speak, I don't fear nobody. I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyone wants to do something to me, come and do something to me. That's why I come to spell the truth. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he said, speak the truth, even though it may be bitter. Speak the truth, even though it may be against yourself. Now I'm going to come with you some big evidences and big proofs for the people to watch. Take notes. Everyone bring a pen and paper, because you're going to get confused what I'm going to say. No, Jordan's going to talk now for a few minutes. And then you lot take your notes, pen and paper, watch what I'm going to do. Use this to destroy anyone's argument. Go on first.
Yeah, so I actually like this topic. So this is, you're talking about revert. Obviously there's different sects in Islam, different madhabs, different opinions. So as a revert, you're going to get different opinions coming left, right and centre, people dragging you certain ways. I've been quite blessed that I've had the brothers from EF Dawah guide me, but also, correct me if I'm wrong, our Prophet, peace be upon him, always guided, told us to take the middle ground. So if something has seemed extreme either way, I've often gone for the middle ground. But it's a good point you've highlighted, and why have you highlighted that?
First of all, I just wanted to say, yeah, my cousin is half English, isn't it? Half Iraqi.
Can I ask you a question? Were your parents Shia?
My dad, he was Sunni, his mum was Sunni, and his dad wasn't religious, so he was a Sunni. He used to pray Sunni, but one day he went to a Shia mosque in Baghdad. He was praying like this, yeah. And then they converted him to Shia. I'll be honest with you. So my dad, he converted to Shia. So that's basically it. But my family in Iraq, they're Sunni and Shia. So obviously I wanted to diss Uncle Omar, the ISIS terrorist. When he comes to this park, I'm going to make sure I'm going to expose this filthy rat, Uncle Omar. The filthy rat, anyone who respects this filthy rat, who disrespects Islam, disrespects the Prophet Muhammad, this ugly dustbin. Uncle Omar is an ugly dustbin walking around. Like, you know, there's a technological dustbin, he's the dustbin. Look at his face, it's like my doormat. Yeah, this disgusting ISIS filthy terrorist, I'm going to expose him, but before I come to him, I'm not going to talk about him now.
You said this wasn't an exposure video.
Oh, no, it's not exposure. Because he tried to attack me, Uncle Omar, yeah? Because ISIS, they hate good people, and I'm a good people. They've got a fatwa on me, bro. Yeah? Not on Jedi, they got it on Modine, bro. But Modine ain't scared of no fatwa, bro. Ban that, bro, yeah? Forget him. He's not even worth my shoe to talk about him. But listen to this, yeah? Even though my shoes are Nike Max, yeah? So don't watch that. Anyway, 110s, yeah? Anyway, listen to this, yeah? Sorry about that. Do you have something to say before I come to the dismantle people's arguments? Because I'm going to dismantle a lot of people in this argument, and people are going to be upset with me, Modine, because Modine is going to bring evidence and finish them off. And anyone who uses these arguments that I'm going to use, you can finish them off as well. All these so-called dawah people. Watch what's going to happen to you right now. Before we come for the finisher, have you got anything to say?
What is
Sorry.
What is the argument? Does anyone know?
No,
we've highlighted points about, you've mentioned about respect to me because I've chosen Islam. Yeah. I made the point that born Muslims go through a similar process. You've mentioned about me using logic and people like that. And then you've dissed Uncle Omar, and then we're here.
Okay. Your body. Let me ask Jordan a question. What controls your hands, legs, your arms, everything? It's your brain, right? So without your brain, your brain has to tell you to move your arm, right? So your body needs a brain. The ummah, this where we're living, needs an imam. If the body needs a brain, a simple body, then this ummah needs an imam. Now this is a very important topic. Whether you like it or not, whether you try and hide it, whether you try and fight it, whether you try and spend billions of petrol money, dollar from Saudi to try and kill people that talk about this, we're gonna still talk about it. Whether you spend people, scholars on dollars on payrolls to try and fight this topic, we're gonna still talk about it. Because this is a fundamental of Islam, usul al-Din, yeah? Now, I know, mashallah, Allah has blessed you with iman, yeah? And you are new to Islam. Before anyone tries to corrupt you, yeah? I have to get to you first, bro. Alhamdulillah, I've got to you first, yeah? I'm here right now and we're still not corrupted. I can see you're still blessed. Unless you start looking like Uncle Omar, you come here, then I'm gonna run away from you, bro. You're gonna be like, yeah, you understand? I'm gonna dust, bro, yeah? Anyway, ban that, bro. Jordan, I wanted to tell you that before I talk about depression, mental health, marriage, divorce, that's another topic. Or do you want to do that topic and forget the other topic?
We can do that topic, yeah.
Are we going to do that? Yeah. All right, I'm going to do, all right. Let me just, before everyone, before I start saying anything, there is a new thing in society where divorce is becoming easy and marriage is becoming hard, yeah? This is causing a lot of people to fornicate. A lot of girls are fornicating, a lot of guys are fornicating. People are becoming gay, people are going to prostitutes. Why? It's because the parents and the scholars and the mosques and the society, all of you are to blame, are not helping people get married. So I'm gonna just, before I say anything, yeah? This was just for the society, help people get married. If you see a woman that's not married, find her a man that's not married and try and join them together. Because by doing this, you will be doing Amar bil Ma'ruf wa Nahy an Munkar. Do you have anything to say about that?
I might do, but you might not like it.
No, say.
So do you agree, you're not preaching, but you're saying things. So for you to say something to me, you need to be the article yourself.
Yeah.
You need to be, everything you're saying, you need to be doing. You need to be not just telling me, you need to be showing me.
Yeah.
So, what's wrong with tattoos? Yeah, it's not haram. No, it's not haram. No, it's not. According to who is it haram?
Here's something.
It's under the skin. It's not over the skin.
Yeah. I like you. I support you. I think there are. You have a talent that could possibly call people to Islam. But you are somebody that chirps his girls on camera, does all these things, which goes against what I understand. And now you are saying about fornication to a crowd. Look, some of these people might be saying, but hang on a minute, this is the guy that was chasing two girls down the street. Two hours ago.
All right, good point. Good point from Brother John Cena.
I'm not trying to.
John Cena.
John
Cena, yeah. Listen.
Hey, John Cena was fine. I'm on your side, yeah?
Thank
I'm
you.
On your
side. Listen. First of all, as you can see, it's Gay Pride Week here. Now, I don't want to become a batty man.
I didn't know.
That's why I chirps girls. I just want to say that. That's what I'm going to say. Because chirps and girls. What's the opposite of white? Black, right? What's the opposite of cold? Hot? What's the opposite of chirps in? Being batting man, innit? Khalas, I'm joking. No, I've got a chirps, bro. I need to get married, bro. I'm doing anything. No one's going to help me. I have to help yourself. All right, sorry. So basically, I stick to the talk. I just wanted to say, unfortunately, the Muslims today, they say, most Muslims, or most schools of Islam, they say the Prophet's parents are in hell, his uncle's in hell, and the enemies of the Prophet that killed the Prophet, chopped the Prophet's uncle's fingers off, ate his liver, destroyed Muslim for 30 years, oh, they're in heaven. Now, I wanted to get this logic and get this evil out of the system, because the Prophet's parents, we believe, are in heaven. The Prophet's uncle, Abu Talib, who protected the Prophet, if it wasn't for him, Islam would have been destroyed. He was protecting him and was doing taqiyah from the pagan Arabs. The Prophet's parents, the most wonderful people in the universe. His grandparents were all on the Abrahamic religion. Unfortunately, today in Islam, the people that are the Prophet's parents, they say, oh, they're in hell, they're mushrik, they're kafir. The Prophet's parents, his mom, Aminah, yeah? And then the people like Abu Sufyan and Hind, who chopped up the Prophet, who killed the Prophet for 30 years, who caused damage, their children killed the Prophet's children, their bloodline killed the Prophet's bloodline. These people are the best people and they are in heaven. This is one thing I wanted to talk about because it doesn't make sense, bro. It's two things that it doesn't make sense, bro. There's a reason for this, because the historians were either, who are narrating hadiths and bigging these people up, were either related to them or getting money from them. This is not right, you understand? So there's a lot of things that are wrong in Muslim, in the aqidah of Muslim. I'm not having a go at no one, because like I said, Sunni Shia, we're all brothers. And I don't even like saying that, because I'm just Muslim, I'm not in no sect. But people need to understand that shouldn't stop attacking the Prophet's family, and they should stop bigging up his enemies. His enemies that ate his uncle's liver, and they big her up, they say, she's the best woman, don't talk about her. See, that's what I'm trying to say. There's this twisted logic, there's some oppression going on, people are scared to speak the truth. Now, I'm gonna, that's one thing I wanted to say. Do you have anything to say about that?
No.
You don't have nothing to say, right? Okay. The second thing I would say.
Maybe one thing.
Go on.
So you, obviously this, linking it back to revert, at what stage do you think a revert should be looking at the stuff you're talking about? Because would you agree, if a revert comes into the deen, they need to get their five pillars, they need to get their salah down straight away.
All right.
And obviously these are more important at the moment than the stuff you're talking about.
Of course.
Important.
I agree with you.
But it can actually throw reverts off.
That's why I waited all this time to talk to you about it. You understand? Because I know you're new, so I'll give you a bit to sink in, and I've come to you now. Regarding, people are saying, why is the imams not mentioned specifically in the Quran, for example? And even though it is mentioned specifically, But they're like, oh, why isn't the 12 names mentioned? Let me ask you a question. Who was in the prophet with the prophet in the cave? Someone answer me. Exactly. Is his name mentioned in the Quran? No, exactly. That's your argument is done about the imams now. Why do you get his name from the hadiths? We get it from the hadiths as well.
Yeah, but okay? He's not on the same level as
I'm just no, but no. I wanted to ask you a question. Anyone who cares, 1 second. Okay, let me finish it. Okay. The Ahlul Bayt, you lot don't know about Hadith Kisa, but I'm not going to go on that because you're still new, yeah? Okay, let me ask you a question. One second, answer my question. If someone curses Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman, is he a kafir? No, I'm just asking no Muslim. Is he a kafir? If you say he is a kafir, then you have made the Khalifs Usuluddin. Do you understand? You have made it a fundamental of your belief. If you say he is kafir, do you understand? Now, I want someone who's got knowledge here, come and stand in front of me. Okay, everyone here is learning. Okay, no problem. But this is one point you have to ask the people. Now, regarding Jordan, I'm not going to be too harsh on him because I know he's still learning. But like I said, yeah, there was 100,000 Sahaba. Yeah, 100,000. We're saying 12 imams are perfect. You're saying 100,000 of them are perfect. So when I speak to Shamsi, he says all 100,000 of them are perfect. They don't have no sins. Okay, Shamsi, if you're saying this, for example, why did the Surah Al-Munafiqeen come down? إِذَا جَاءَكَ الْمُنَافِقُونَ. That means more than one. Why did that come down? If you're saying they're perfect, why did they run away in Uhud and Ahzab? So obviously there is some that are good and we love them, and there's some that are munafiqeen. Why did they run away and leave the bet in the Yawm al-Ahzab? Hunayn, they ran away, they left the Prophet by himself and Imam Ali defending him, for example, yeah? So you can't say all of them. In Salat al-Jum'ah, in Surah al-Jum'ah, you know there's a surah called Jum'ah, it says the Prophet is giving lecture and they left him and they went to do trade. They left the Prophet with Imam Ali in Salat al-Jum'ah and they done trade, for example. This verse is condemning them. So you can't say all of them, 100,000 of them are perfect. But when I say to the 12 Imams are ma'soom and they have been sent by Allah, just like Jesus had 12 disciples, Moses had 12 disciples, and then they start saying to me, oh, why does the Imams have special powers? Special powers sometimes. Let me ask you a question. Solomon in the Quran, he had his secretary called Asif. He brought the palace of Sheba from Palestine all the way to Yemen in the blink of an eye. This is in the Quran. I challenge anyone here to challenge me now. I'll give you £1,000 if I'm lying. What's the question? 1 second.
The only people I've heard argue this is the Shia.
No, I'm just Muslim. Okay. Listen. Listen to what I'm saying carefully. The secretary of Solomon, his name is Asif, is in the Quran. Solomon said, who can bring me the palace of Sheba from Jordan, from Palestine to Yemen? One of the jinn said, I can bring it to you. This is in the Quran, by the way, so don't try and tell me I'm wrong. Another man, he said, I can bring it to you before you close your eyes. This is a normal man. He's not a prophet. He's not an imam. He is the successor of a prophet, Sulaiman. And Imam Ali is the successor of the Prophet Muhammad. And Prophet Muhammad is greater than Sulaiman. So what can Imam Ali do that Asif cannot do? In a blink of an eye, this is in the Quran, anyone who says it's not, I challenge them, £10,000 I'll give them. Even though I don't have £10,000, I can give them £1,000. Yeah? With a blink of an eye, he brought the palace like this. Solomon opened his eyes, he saw the palace of Sheba in front of him. I'm just saying, so anyone who argues the Prophet Muhammad is greater than Sulaiman, so the powers of Imam Ali is greater than the secretary of okay.
Yeah, no, sorry. I'm listening.
Do you have anything to say? If you don't have, I'll carry on.
What you're saying doesn't actually sound familiar, but I'm not going to comment on that.
Sorry, you're not going to comment?
No.
Okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran there's a third authority. وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولِهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. What's that? There's a third authority. So who's the third authority? We say is the Imams. Who do you say, for example? Allah says about Ibrahim, جَعَلَكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا. For example, yeah? Allah makes someone an Imam. It's not our choice to make someone an Imam. I can't come and say you're going to be an Imam. Allah makes someone an Imam. Now, who is greater, Abu Hurairah or Imam Ali? Obviously Imam Ali, everyone's going to say this. Imam Ali is the greatest man after the Holy Prophet, yeah? If I bring you hadiths from Imam Ali, why do you not accept them? Why do you love the enemies of Imam Ali, for example?
Is Umar not considered the second greatest Muslim?
The second greatest Muslim is Imam Ali. Imam Ali said, anyone who says, yeah? Imam Ali said, I am the Farooq. Okay, Imam Ali says, I am the Farooq. I am the Sadiq al-Akbar. The Prophet named me this. Anyone who says this is a says that for themselves is a liar. So this name, Farooq and Sadiq, is for Imam Ali. Now, you said, for example, I got another point. Take notes. You said Saqifa, we say Ghadir. Allah chose the Imam Ali in the day of Ghadir. Shamsi says, no, Saqifa. We made the elections and we chose someone. Regarding this, because of Saqifa, Yazid now sits on the throne and has got the head of Imam Hussein, the grandson of the Prophet, and Yazid is drinking alcohol. Because of Saqifa. Because of the day of Saqifa, Yazid is sitting with Imam Hussein's head, drinking alcohol on Imam Hussein's head. And Imam Hussein is the grandson of the Prophet Muhammad. So the Saqifa was wrong. Okay? Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yeah, He mentions in the Quran so many verses about Imam. Well, there's 12 verses, but they are very strong. The problem with the people, they've got so much hate for Imam Ali. Even Ibn Abbas, who is one of the greatest scholars, he said, we used to bring the child when he's born, we take him to Imam Ali. If he hates Imam Ali, like he start crying, we know he's a child of zina. He's born from not wedlock, because the Prophet says, Ahmad ibn Hanbal says, the Prophet said to the Imam Ali, none will hate you except for a child of zina or a munafiq or a child of the reds. Like of the reds. This is in Ahmad ibn Hanbal says this in his book, Fada'il al-Sahaba. So no one can argue with me, because Ahmad ibn Hanbal has got a book called Fada'il al-Sahaba, the blessings of the Sahaba. 3/4 of it is about Imam Ali. Ahmad ibn Hanbal is the leader of the Wahhabis and the Salafis. And bring it from your own books. Fada'il al-Sahaba, tell Shamsi to read it. I'll bring Fada'il al-Sahaba, let Shamsi read it. And if he rejects Ahmad ibn Hanbal, then he is not a Salafi or a Wahhabi. He is nobody. Yeah? Okay?
Yeah, you're saying a lot of stuff. It'd be good to take my email and send me the sources of what you're... Okay. Not that I'm not believing what you're saying, but you're saying a lot of stuff. It'd be good for me to hear from the source. But because a couple of times you said them and us, you are creating a Shia.
No, we say we the best, like DJ Khaled, we the best, we're all one family. Yeah. We are one family. I'm not, anyone who does disunity, I will slap him in his face. We're all one family. My family is Shia, Sunni, it doesn't matter. We're all one. But we need to find the truth. That's why I'm in Speaker's Corner. We're not here to fight, we're here to discuss. You bring me evidence, I bring you evidence. If you're right, I follow you. If I'm right, then I have done my part. For when I die, Allah says, did you talk more? I said, I talked in front of the world. All right, 3 minutes left.
Oh, I have a question.
All right, quickly.
If we're all about unity, and we are all, which I agree with, do you think Shia Sunni debates, for instance, in the park are productive? Because they're going out to a lot of non-Muslims who may just look at it as a division.
Regarding the non-Muslims, when they start doing research, it will be interesting for them. So the truth will always prevail. If I'm right or if you're right, it will have to win. So even if we're discussing, the truth will come out. You can't beat the truth, bro. So if I'm truthful, he's on the truth. I'm with my brother. We're on the same boat. I love this brother. We're on the same boat. I believe what he believes in. Do you understand? But I just wanted to say, the Muhajirin and Ansar, like, obviously we love them. But obviously, sometimes the Quran condemns them. Sometimes the Quran praises them. Do you understand? Allah says to the Prophet, you are the greatest manners. Some brothers, they say the Prophet frowned at a blind man. Abasa wa tawalla, they say that came down on the Prophet. When that didn't come down on the Prophet, that came down on Uthman. Because Allah says to the Prophet, you have the greatest manners. So how can you say the Prophet frowned at a blind man? You're trying to violate the Prophet by saying this verse came down on him. So there's a lot of people that are claiming to be Muslim and violating the Prophet with the hadiths. Do you understand? There's, let me tell you one thing. Nisa'i is the biggest Sunni scholar. Nisa'i. How did he die? He died from praising Imam Ali. They've tortured him so much, he was praising Imam Ali. So go and read about Nisa'i. You've heard of Nisa'i, right? Everyone's heard of him. He's a Sunni scholar, the biggest Sunni scholar. He was killed, tortured to death just because he was praising Imam Ali. Imagine this. Go and do your research, yeah? Because he said to Muawiyah, They said to him, praise Muawiyah. He said, I've got nothing to say for Muawiyah. He said, but I can say from now, if I talk all my life, it won't stop about Imam Ali. They killed him. And he's the biggest Sunni scholar. So anyone who's got love for Imam Ali, he's going to be killed. He's going to be tortured. That's why we're not scared. You blow us up, you chop us up, you hang our heads on here. We're not scared of you. We say the truth. Look at me. I will keep on exposing the truth. And I will let the world know what the true Islam is. Because the terrorist Islam has hijacked Islam. They're a cancer to Islam. I don't want to say names, but you don't know who they are. They have now given the worst image to Islam. People are running away from Islam because of these people. People are making Islam the worst religion by their actions. And I'm not going to say names. Yeah? But I'm here, inshallah. If I'm still alive, I will keep saying the truth. And one day, inshallah, it will come. I just wanted to say one thing. Yeah? When Aisha and Muawiyah fighted the fourth Khalif, who was Imam Ali, what do you say about that? A person who fights the fourth Khalif, is he a kafir or is he a Muslim? No, I'm asking. Because they say if you dissing the Khalif, you're a kafir. What if a person tries to kill the Khalif? Is he a kafir or Muslim? If he goes to war with him? These are questions you have to ask these people. Yeah? Read Nahj al-Balagha. Three sermons, Imam Ali says, I remained patient when they took the Khilafah from him. Three sermons, Imam Ali. He had to stay patient to save Islam. Yeah? Khalid ibn Walid, ask Shamsi, why did Khalid ibn Walid, who's a Sahabi, chop up the Ansari's head, Malik ibn Nuwayra, use his head as a coal to light the fire, and then raped his wife the same night? Ask Shamsi this. On the orders of Abu Bakr, because he did not pay money to Abu Bakr, the zakat. Abu Bakr ordered Khalid ibn, this is in Tabari, this is ibn Kathir, Malik ibn Nuwayra, get this name right. He's a Sahabi from the Ansar. Yeah, Ansar Muhajirin. His wife was raped by Khalid ibn Walid and his head was cooked in the under the food just because he didn't pay the zakat to Abu Bakr. So if a person he doesn't pay zakat, what if a person tries to fight the Khalifa, for example? Which like Muawiyah. So Shamsi, you need to ask these questions to Shamsi. There's a million more, a million. But obviously, TNTS Greek, he's telling me more, you got 2 minutes. Yeah, he said that time. So Jordan, obviously Jordan is my brother, but I don't know if you lot took your pens and papers and wrote down what I'm saying. Because you're going to have to use these arguments when you see someone like Shamsi or any other guy. And put these arguments and say, no, give me an answer now, bruv. Don't try to run away. You have to get them. There's a thousand more. I'm not going to say them now. But read Ziyarat Ashura. Yeah? And I just wanted to say, Shamsi comes from a school that loves Muawiyah and Abu Sufyan. He loves the enemies of the Prophet Muhammad. He loves the people that chopped up the Prophet Muhammad's family. So what can I do? I can just advise him for my brother, fi sabilillah, because I want to save him. And Jordan, we're all going to die. When we die, they're going to come to us in a grave. They say, did you speak the truth? I said, no, I was too scared. I was thinking about my dunya. They're going to say, naughty boy, for example.
Kanasha, did you think Shamsi does a great job calling people to Islam?
Shamsi, I love him, fi sabilillah, when he calls people to Islam. Yeah. And that is what I love him for. He's my brother. But because he's my brother, if I see a whole...
So this is why for me, trying to discredit him online.
I'm not discrediting him. If I see my brother, Shamsi, he's like my blood brother. If I see him going to fall down, and he's going to fall down, I say, Shamsi, bro, you're going to fall down. There's a hole over there. Habibi, don't go there. Because I love him, I'm trying to warn him. If I say, nah, go on, Shamsi, go in that hole. I don't care about you. Go, go. And I laugh in his face. Is that my brother? Because I love him, because I love Shamsi, I'm trying to grab him. I'm trying to save him. I want to say, Shamsi, don't go in that path. That path is wrong. That's why I say this. I don't say out of hate. Shamsi is my brother. Abdul Hamid is my brother. Even Abdul Hamid today, TNTS was there. We shaked hands, we hugged. Abdul Hamid is my brother. Abdul Hamid and Shamsi, they're both my brothers. I don't really have no, we're all Muslim. But I have to speak the truth. And there's so much more I can say, bro. But you don't have time. You don't have time. All right. Allahumma salli.